everyone, a very good evening. You're watching The Money Show on ET Now's Rise with India Primetime segment. I'm Mubina Kapasi, and we have an action-packed edition of The Money Show lined up for you with so much happening in the equity markets globally as well. Bond markets, equity markets, hammered out of shape. And I'm sure you guys are wondering, how exactly should you manage your finances, your money? Should you pull out from your mutual funds? Should you decrease your SIPs? Should you increase your SIPs? Any questions or queries that you may be having, we're going to get it answered on The Money Show today. And we have for that Mrin Agarwal, who will be joining us in the very first segment. But amidst all of that, we also hopped over to a nearby chemist and found out that there's a serious lack of hand sanitizers as well as masks, your basic hygiene products. And mind you, there are certain counterfeit ones available, but their prices are extremely high and they don't even serve the purpose. We'll get you an interaction with one such chemist. And finally, in our Spend with TMS segment, remember, come 1st of April, car companies will not be able to sell the BS4 engine vehicles, which means that any existing inventory that they have of the older version, that's the BS4 engines, they'll probably give it to you, the customer, at a deep discount. We'll be talking about the discounts that car companies are offering on various cars and which one should you buy, if there is any that you should be buying at this juncture. Well, the coronavirus pandemic is something that has spooked equity markets, not just in India, but across the globe. In fact, the Nifty 50 as well did see some gains today in the early hours, but that too was completely sold into. This, in fact, was the biggest two-day fall that we have seen on the Indian equity markets since October 2008. It's quite a drubbing that all asset classes, equities, debt, even gold for that matter, which is often considered as a safe haven, has received. And I'm sure in the midst of all of this, you may be wondering, what exactly should you be doing with any investable surplus that you may be having? And also, if you've already parked your money in mutual funds, as I'm sure a lot of you have already done, what should you do with that? Should you just stay put with it? Should you use this dip as an opportunity to increase the amount of SIPs you do on a monthly basis? Or should you consider pausing your SIPs? I'm sure these are the questions that are on your mind. And what else could be done to manage your finances in such crucial times? To talk about this and more, and of course, not to mention to also answer any questions or queries you may be having on this important day, I have with me Mrin Agarwal, founder and director of FinSafe. Thank you, Mrin. It's always a pleasure having you with us on The Money Show. I'm sure a lot of your clients have as well been calling you, emailing you, texting you, asking you, what should they do with their money at this juncture? Equity markets have fallen. And you know, we often say that when markets are low is when you should buy, because, you know, it's your chance to get more units at a lower price. Is that something that you would advise, that, you know, since markets are lower, you should buy? Or would you advise that just stay the course, don't do anything, stay put with the mutual funds that you have right now, just continue with the SIPs that you are doing?
Good evening, everybody, and nice to be here on the show today, Mubina. Yes, I think it's a very difficult time for most people to figure out what to do. But if you do have money, I think the first thing that you need to really do is to see where can you basically invest as per your financial goals, and where can you basically add on to your financial goals. And in terms of what you should do, I think you should basically spread it out over a couple of tranches, depending upon what your financial goal is, and spread it out in tranches rather than doing it in a lump sum.
Okay, so basically lump sum investment, any which ways, I don't think a lot of personal finance experts advocate. So I suppose, Mrin, what you are saying is that even if you do have some money, just ensure that you don't put all of it into the equity markets right now. You essentially spread it out. So Mrin, let's say if somebody already has mutual funds, already has their SIPs going, like a lot of our viewers already have SIPs going on currently, would you say that they should take advantage of this lower price and let's say if your SIP is 10,000 rupees, maybe increase it to 15,000 or 20,000 rupees. Is today and, you know, now the right time to do so?
Yeah, I think, you know, Mubina, honestly, like, I'm having a lot of people who are asking me very worried questions, actually, about the fact that the returns on their investments have fallen considerably. And I think, you know, the point to always remember is that nothing is going to last forever. And if you look, even if you look at previous data, you know, markets have bounced back within a year when these big falls have happened. So I think, you know, the first thing is that for people who have already invested in SIPs, and if they're really worried about their SIPs and the returns on their SIPs, then the first thing is to, first of all, stay calm and stay invested. There are many questions coming. Should I move my money into a liquid fund, or, you know, should I redeem and should I look at multi-cap or large cap funds instead of mid-cap funds? I would say just remain invested. Again, for those who've already invested and who have some surplus to add on, please invest it in the same schemes. You know, don't go around trying to find other schemes. I mean, ensure that you have invested only in 5 or 6 funds and try to add on to those funds. I think one of the other things to be cognizant about is the fact that if you're having too much of allocation or too much of skew towards a particular market cap, this is a good way to actually reduce that that skew that exists. So let's say in a portfolio you have like 60-70% towards mid cap and you've done it based on near term performance, I think now is a good time to then look at adding in some bit of multi cap funds or maybe other funds in the portfolio.
But you know, Mrin, is now also a good time to give your portfolio a review? You know, we are at the end of the financial year and many investors, many of our viewers say that maybe, you know, we always recommend that you should do an annual review of your portfolio. Many of them use the end of the financial year to do that annual review of the portfolio. So like you're mentioning, doing that bit of rebalance between multi-caps, mid-caps, small-caps. If we say rebalance, it means we have to redeem, you know, some of our money from certain categories of funds. Now, the NAVs already are so depressed. So would you recommend redeeming them now?
Not immediately, actually. And when I say review of portfolio, I think, you know, the first thing that I think most investors need to do is to firstly figure out whether you have actually invested in certain funds based on your financial goals. Because as we see with a lot of retail investors, they tend to basically invest in funds and then figure out later on what they're going to use the money for. So I think given the fact that all of us are now homebound, I think it's a good idea to also spend some time on your portfolio. And first and foremost, look at allocating your investments towards your financial goals if you've already not done so. The second thing is that when you review performance, it always is relative performance, relative to the category average and relative to the benchmark. So you need to see how your fund has performed in different time periods versus the category average performance. So for example, if you are holding a multi-cap fund, how is your fund done against the multi-cap category? And then if there has been a terrible amount of underperformance over an 18-month period, then maybe you can look at, you know, start watching the fund. I mean, I don't think that this is a good time to basically take those exit calls because, I mean, at this point in time, everything is down. But I think, you know, you can start keeping it on a watch list or a track list to see how it does over the next couple of months.
Well, that's one way of utilizing your time at home productively, you know, reviewing your financial goals, seeing if the funds that you have in your portfolio essentially will help you achieve those financial goals. Okay, Mrin, there's another topic that I would like to talk to you about, and that's with respect to the announcement by the RBI. Just a quick question, actually, before I go to that, I wanted to talk to you about the importance of debt funds in the portfolio, even gold for that matter. Very often when we say investing, in our minds, it's equity mutual funds. And, you know, that's where a lot of investor attention is, retail investor attention is. But, you know, I think at this juncture, the way the market has moved, it brings to light the importance of diversification, right? About having gold, a little bit of gold in your portfolio, though mind you, that as well has come off quite significantly. But nevertheless, it does add that bit of diversity in your portfolio. Similarly, having debt funds in your portfolio, the yields over there as well have come down significantly. So how would you essentially describe the importance of having these two categories of assets in your portfolio? And again, what should be the split? Is this the right time to nibble in to ensure diversification?
Yes, actually, you know, where asset allocation is concerned, it's also a good time to see that is your portfolio entirely in equity, or again, is it majorly in equity, or is it majorly in a traditional investment? And to basically see how you can diversify your portfolio better, so that, you know, it basically can withstand, you know, the shock. So like right now, anybody who has a major allocation to equity, obviously the portfolio is going to be down as compared to if they had some amount of debt funds. Now, within the debt category, as we've seen, there's been a lot that's been happening. And one of the biggest things that I am seeing is that most investors have chosen funds based on near-term performance. So right now, I have seen people cribbing about credit risk funds. And then in all my sessions, people are asking me about gilt funds. And we all know why, because 2019 was a good year for gilt funds. So people are talking about investment in gilt funds. So again, I think, you know, the basics need to be very clear, that stick on to maybe an ultra short or a short-term fund, depending upon your investment horizon. If you've never done debt funds before, I mean, the last thing you want to do is get into a dynamic bond or into a credit risk or even a gilt fund for that matter, right? So, you know, ensure that you allocate some money towards debt. I think as far as gold is concerned, you know, we typically say 5 to 10% in gold, and most Indian households in any case have more than that. So somehow I would not suggest more allocation to gold.
Okay, well, before I take any questions and queries, let me just ask Mrin one more question, and that's with respect to the announcement yesterday made by RBI, long-term repo operations. Now, it's a term that's pretty complicated, but essentially speaking, it's to ensure that when the Central Bank of India, that's RBI, cuts interest rates, the banks as well pass on those lower interest rates to customers like you and me. So this time around, they have done an LTRO of 1 lakh crore rupees, which means 1 lakh crore rupees of cheap money, that's basically money at lower interest rates, will be infused in the banking system. So Mrin, you know, as maybe a customer, as a home loan, you know, borrower, as an EMI payer, would this LTRO help me in any way? Could I see my EMI bill tomorrow decrease?
Hopefully is what I would say, because if you look at what has happened, right? So if you see the last 1 year, the interest rates or the repo rate was actually reduced by 135 basis points. But if you look at the reduction in the MCLR rate, it was only about 65 basis points. So I think what has happened is that just by rate cuts, the transmission has not been happening. And that is why these LTROs have come about, where essentially RBI is giving money at the repo rate to the banks, with the idea being to bring down their cost of funding. So if their cost of funding comes down, hopefully they can pass it on to the customers. If you look at what has happened over the last 1 month, so I think they came out with an LTRO last month as well. And some of the banks did reduce their MCLR by 10 to 15 basis points. Now, the key thing that one has to note is that it is the MCLR linked loans that are going to come down due to this. So currently you have external benchmark linked loans like repo loans, those will not come down. But hopefully with the LTRO and providing money at a low cost to the banks, the consumers at the end of the day can see a reduction in their home and possibly car loan rates as well.
Okay. Well, folks, we'll be talking about this topic a bit more elaborately tomorrow. So if you have any questions or queries with respect to your loans, write them into us. But for now, let's take some queries on the equity markets, on mutual funds as well. And this is our Ask the Money Show segment. If you have any questions, you can call in. 2499-0300 is the number. You can email us as well. Well, first up, let's take on board the whole host of email queries that we have received. Bear with us. We've been getting a lot of emails of late. We're going to try and get all of them answered one by one. First up, we have Mr. Hari Prasad, who has written into us saying, which are the best liquid funds to park money in for the next 2 or 3 months? Are arbitrage funds better than liquid funds for the same time frame? And also, he is asking about the funds offered by one AMC, that's Axis AMC. Axis offers a liquid fund as well as an arbitrage fund. So, Mrin, liquid versus arbitrage, which one would be better? From my limited knowledge, I understand that arbitrage funds do tend to offer that, you know, 0.5%, 1% better return compared to liquid funds. But then again, they would carry maybe a bit more risk as well. So if you have to park your money for the next 2-3 months, you don't want to put it in a savings account, you obviously want a bit more than that 4-5% that a savings account generates, where would you recommend? And also Axis AMC, would that be somewhere you'd recommend Hari park his money?
So I would not recommend arbitrage for 2-3 months. Also, given the fact that now dividends are going to be taxable, you know, it's not a good idea to get into an arbitrage for less than a year. So arbitrage funds are taxed as equity funds. And hence, it will be ideal to have at least a 1 year holding time frame for an arbitrage fund. In his case, since he specifically mentioned 2-3 months, I would actually recommend a liquid fund or an ultra short-term fund. I think the Axis liquid fund that he talked about is fine. On the ultra short-term side, he can look at ICICI, he can look at the SBI ultra short-term fund as well.
Okay, so a liquid fund would win over an arbitrage fund. And plus, you know, you have to look at the tax efficiency angle as well. You know, since dividend is now being taxed, it may not be the most lucrative option to essentially pick something like that. Hari, I hope your question has been answered. Let's move on and take on board our next query. Vinay Bhaseen writes into us saying, should I shift from credit risk to equity hybrid or multi-cap equity funds? Wants to invest for at least 3 years. Now, I understand where his question is coming from because, you know, this entire Yes Bank fiasco has actually caused a credit risk fund itself to be one of the biggest losers in terms of NAV. I think it was a UTI credit risk fund, if I'm not mistaken, that saw more than 20% decline in the NAV. So, Vinay has already invested in a credit risk fund. He's not mentioned which AMC, but he's considering moving to a hybrid or a multi-cap equity fund. Now, unfortunately, he's not shared with us his entire portfolio, which would enable us to take a more holistic view at it. But yeah, just objectively, if we have to look at it, given the current market conditions and given the fact that he has at least 3 years in his hands, Mrin, what would you recommend?
Given that he has only 3 years in his hand, I would not recommend the equity hybrid or the equity fund because 3 years is a very short period. Markets can be extremely volatile. And hence, and typically for an equity hybrid or an equity fund, you need to have at least a 6-7 year time frame. So from a 3 year perspective, well, I always recommend short term funds because I find that the risk adjusted returns are very consistent in short term funds. Now, as far as the credit risk fund is concerned, what he needs to do is to evaluate why he wants to get out of it. Is it because it's one of the funds that has had these NAVs drop because of, you know, whole lot of issues? And if that's the case, what he must realize is, well, the NAV is already dropped and that amount has been side pocketed and nobody knows as to when that amount is going to come back, right? So if he is, you know, worried about it and if he feels that this was a wrong fund choice, and he does not want a debt fund with this sort of volatility, then I would recommend that he moves it into a short-term debt fund.
So that's the recommendation coming in from Mrin on how you can essentially tweak your portfolio. Let's take on board our next email query that we have received today. This one is from Mr. Kannan K. He says, I've invested about 31 lakh rupees over the last 6 to 7 years in the following manner. 33% in hybrid, 22% in equity, 11% in multi-cap, 8% in large cap, 3% in mid caps, 36% in liquid funds, and 9% in bonds. So there's a huge chunk of his money in liquid funds. He wants to know that, so basically he's looking for an overall return of at least 10 to 12% over the next 2 to 3 years. Returns from the equity funds is around 9.6%. Hybrid is giving a bit lower return of 4.5%. Liquid is giving 7%, and bond is giving 7.5%. Now he wants to know that given the current scenario, how could one manage bond funds, long-term funds, short-term, as well as gilt funds in the falling ROI scenario? And again, how to handle liquid and debt funds to get the best returns? He wants to know if he must make a switch to equity instead, and he does not need his liquid funds for at least the next 1 year. So Mrin, 36% in liquid funds, and he's again interested in knowing how to essentially strategize in liquid and debt funds to get the best returns. I think he's also mulling switching over to equities. So you have the portfolio, Mrin. In fact, he's given the returns as well on what he's getting in each category. So Mrin, any tweaks you'd recommend he make?
Well, first and foremost, I am kind of presuming that he's kept a lot of money in liquid because, you know, he's kind of still undecided as to where he wants to invest. But when I look at the portfolio, you know, I find that he has too many categories of funds, right? So, you know, between his equity and balance, I think he has 7 or 8 categories of funds, and he's pretty much invested in every category. Now, if you actually look at the allocation, I think the way it was looking was that about 60-65% is actually allocated in debt funds and the balance is in equity funds. If you look at the debt funds, at one side you have liquid funds and on the other side you basically have, credit risk fund and a gilt fund, right? So firstly, I think that there are just too many funds in his portfolio. On the equity side, there is a sector fund. I think there's a thematic fund and there's a value fund as well. I think he needs to get out of these sort of funds, number one. Also because, you know, he's expecting quite high returns. I don't think that the value fund will fit in into his strategy. Now, I think he needs to tone down his expectations because expecting a 10 to 12% return on a portfolio, which is 60-65% in debt, of which, you know, a large chunk is into liquid, cannot fetch you a 10 to 12% return. So I think he really needs to tone down his expectations. He needs to increase his holding period, number one, on the equity side, certainly. And on the debt side, I think he's basically in the very high risk funds. I would still suggest that with the liquid funds, if he wants to keep that money into debt itself, I think he should move into the short-term category. Within that, look at funds which have a higher AAA exposure. So, for example, you have SBI, you have IDFC short-term fund, which he can look at considering. So, yes, my key takeaways are, one, he has to really tone down his return expectations considering he's looking at 3 years. It looks very unlikely to get a 10 to 12% return. Unless, of course, there's a huge, huge return from equity. Second is that on the money in liquid, since he said 1 year, the only option he really has is a low duration fund. But if he can increase it a little, maybe he could look at doing a short-term fund. And third is, I think he really needs to consolidate his portfolio and he needs to bring down the number of funds, certainly exit the sector funds, thematic fund and the value fund as well.
So you want 10 to 12% return, but you know, if you're going to keep a majority of your money in the debt market, in the liquid market, it may be difficult to get that kind of returns because, you know, historically as well, it's equities that have really been the wealth creators that have generated that double-digit return on an annual basis for a lot of investors. Of course, they do carry as well a bit higher risk, but like we say, right, risk and return go hand in hand. So, Kannan, these are the chops and changes that Mrin has recommended for your portfolio. Well, folks, we'll not be able to take any more queries in today's episode. But don't fret. Keep writing into us on themoneyshow@etnow.tv. And over the course of the next few days, we'll keep getting your questions and queries answered. Mrin, always a pleasure chatting with you. Thanks so much for very patiently getting helping our viewers out with their questions. Well, The Minister of State for Finance, Mr. Anurag Thakur, today in a Parliament question and answer round has said that there is no plan to discontinue the 2000 rupee note. Remember that speculation was rife that, you know, the government may be veering around discontinuing the high value note. That's the 2000 rupee note that was introduced during demonetization. In fact, I'm sure that the chats that you may be having with your family members, you know, with your friends on WhatsApp or even personally, you may have, you know, brought up this topic about the 2000 rupee notes being discontinued. There even being murmurs about how it may be demonetized. Well, very clearly, Mr. Anurag Thakur has said that there's no plan to withdraw the 2000 rupee note, and they're still being dispensed through many bank ATMs. In fact, that may also be a reason why many of you may be having this question on your minds, because a lot of the banks stopped, you know, essentially distributing the 2000 rupee notes. Now, he said that getting change for the 2000 rupee notes was becoming a problem, and all of us have been through that. And hence, banks like, you know, SBI, Indian Bank decided to reconfigure their ATM to support the lower denomination of 500 rupee notes as well. So, important clarification coming in there from the government. On that note, we will take a very short break on The Money Show. Do come right back. We are going to be addressing this entire coronavirus situation. And unfortunately, the lack of hygiene products being available at your mom and pop chemist stores.